Hello, Brett from Wrike here with a little demo on using our import tool to import data into Wrike. Now, the first thing to understand is that we can use this to import an Excel file, that's XLS or CSV, or a Microsoft Project file. If you need help with projects, that's a separate conversation that's going to be focusing on the Excel import today. Now, this import is a one-time import. We typically use this when we're just bringing in data initially from another system. Once it's in Wrike, we typically are going to be wanting to use Wrike and say the table view to edit and adjust that data, as importing new versions would not overwrite the originals that we imported. It rather just creates its own separate entities. Now, to use this import tool, like I said, it has to be an Excel or CLS file, a CSV file format. But once we do that, we have to have the actual data is going to have specific columns and be in a specific order, if you will. There are two methods of that. The first and main one, the more intuitive one, is this Excel file sample right here. So we're going to go from build. Typically, we want to build an import folder like this. Click on the three dots. I usually am operating in table view when it comes to imports, but you don't have to. And we want to click on import into from Excel and grab this sample Excel file. Now that's going to force our browser to download it. We can click on it from there, open it up, and see this format. Now this format shows us a few things. There's all of the columns that you can use to import. And this is not all columns, but it's rather the columns that are showing up here as easily available for you to utilize. But we can use this to import at least some basic data, and you'll see some structure here. When we're importing something as a folder or a project, it has to have a forward slash like that in front of it. We wanted to add something like a subfolder. We can add that here with a second set of forward slashes. Now we have to have this key column. This is always going to be required or it'll error out. This is typically when you do try to use imports and get an error showing up, it will say something like error in key 3. And that tells you that we have a data issue somewhere in this row specifically. So we need that both from the error standpoint, but also just the import requires it. The names of the tasks, projects, or folders are going to go here in column B. The things like status group goes here in or status goes here in column C. The rest of these are pretty intuitive. I usually leave priority alone. Assign to goes into an assignee name. You could technically use email or the actual name as long as that user has a name in their account. If they Donald Duck is in the account, when you do this, there will be a separate window that pops up in the import that says, we think we found Donald Duck. Is it this person? And it might be, you know, Sir Donald Duck inside your account. And it would say, find the closest equivalent and let you map them over. So whether you use email works, that as long as it's the same email they're logged in or their actual name. But either way, we can map in assignee. Things like start date and end date. Duration is technically calculated off this. I don't believe you actually need to fill this out, but you're welcome to, obviously. Things like dependencies, and I usually do this dependencies just inside of Wrike after the import. I don't typically do it during the actual import itself. It's just kind of, you have to know the exact format and how this works, but this is technically saying when key 2 starts, this current row starts. So it's a little trickier in here, but technically doable. Start constraints, I would say let's just avoid that one for now. Usually leave that one blank. And then description only if you want to map to the description section of a task or project. So relatively intuitive. The things to remember is that you're going to need at least all of these columns to be there. Now, the data itself could be blank. If I don't need to fill in all of my description cells, I can delete all of these individual cells, and you'll see that it allows you to actually enter it in blank. But we do need at least the column header here in our format. Now, this is the first file format. This is the easier one to do, but I do want to kind of call out the other more advanced version that has additional columns. Notice this one goes to column K, the other one's going to go to column Z, and it has additional cells you can fill in and import into that are not showing here. For example, you don't see effort on this one. You don't see things like custom fields on this format. There's going to be other things that are other fields that are in that other version that are just not available here. So I want to show the other example as well. We go back to inside of Wrike. We can not only click on the import and Excel, but we can also set up what exactly data we need to bring in here. You can see if I go in table view, say I turn on these custom fields, I turn off progress, I don't need that, or author, but maybe do want a few of these other fields to be importing in, like importance, maybe budget, something along those lines. See exactly the details here, line of business, region, it shows all of those custom fields. And you can then go to the export and click Excel to export this. Usually in this case, it's a blank folder, so it doesn't really make a difference. But if you had examples, you could pick either filtered examples or all examples. We hit export. That asks the system to create a file, which we can then download. Click to download. You do have to actually then open the file. And this will open it in this different format that has additional columns. And I'll show you a better version in a moment. But you can see things like effort that didn't exist before, things like billing questions, and probably most importantly, the custom fields. If we start adding it in those custom fields, it will show those as columns ready for us to import into. So if you're trying to import something like region, this is, you know, North America in row one versus Europe in row two and APAC in row three, et cetera, this is going to allow us to actually import that along with the task that is being imported in that row specifically. Now, one problem with the way I just did it, there was no actual data in my export, so there's nothing underneath here to show you as what the formatting needs to look like. So I'm going to actually use a different example in order to do this. This is an exported version of something nearly identical. This is just this intake folder here. Again, you could just click intake and see how there's some actual data here. Things like effort has been filled out. Some of our custom fields have been filled out. And you can click on the three dots, hit export, and use this all tasks. This will ask you to, again, download the file. Let's open this and take a look at this other more advanced format. So here we'll see that there are going to be things like the task listed out. These are the actual tasks I'm importing. Now we have to say here in column B that which location do those live within? They live within this Anthony's blog project. In this case, I was actually able to, you could use this as a guide to create Anthony's blog or Anthony, you know, Joseph's blog, et cetera, Mary's blog. And so you could use this as an example to, you know, potentially copy and paste these columns and create additional new projects here, Mary's project, Mary's blog. And then and create the tasks one underneath it, task two. And obviously you can copy and paste and use this to show that this lives within Mary's project. It's definitely a little bit more complex, but it allows for us to utilize a little bit more options in other fields. This allows us to do things like status group as well as actual custom statuses, do things like effort, like mentioned earlier, budgeting fields. And again, most importantly, custom fields. And I want to call out that you need to have built the custom field first in your system to obviously have them export and make sure you're using the right type. If line of business is a dropdown, pick line of business 1, 2, or 3. Excel doesn't necessarily know that, but the system will know that there only should be those three options and it will import them as a dropdown. Hopefully that helps. Again, these are the two main ways of doing it. I guess one other thing to call out is when you're getting an error again, look for this key. And you can even see here, if I was trying to import this, this key needs to be pulled down to show, did the wrong way there, but it needs to be pulled down to show that we have a number per actual row here. So usually I use this little trick, highlight, a few of the cells above it. Excel picks up on the pattern, drags it out to row key 20, even though that's for row 21 here, but we need that key to import. When you use the import tool, if you run into an error, it's typically going to tell you the key that you have an error in. You're going to want to take a look at that, the formatting in that row, and see if you have any, if you can figure out what the error is, change it, update it, save the new version, and try uploading the new version. And if there's no more errors, it will load. If there's another error, it'll find it and let you know as well. So keep on working on this one. Again, this is only a little bit more advanced if you need to import things like those custom field data. But you know, hopefully both ways can kind of work for you depending on your needs.